Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Best Science Fiction and Fantasy of the Year, Volume 13, edited by Jonathan Strahan. Narrated by Corey Allen, Morgan Hallett, Catherine Ho, John Keating, Rosalyn Landor, Richard Poe, and Neil Shah. Once Last Time, with Feeling, by Jonathan Strahan. Welcome to the Best Science Fiction and Fantasy of the Year, Volume 13. 2018 was a difficult year for everyone living on the third rock from the sun. The United States, at least from this outsider's perspective, looked more and more like an awful parody of itself, although change was visible, even from abroad, and there seemed reason to believe things might just be okay. The United Kingdom faced its own political upheaval throughout the year, and the story in Australia, where this book is compiled, was much the same. And while those of us living in the former North American and British Commonwealth publishing territories danced, the world spun madly on. Astonishing weather events, species die-offs, and tragedies no one could escape. The rest of the world, where most of humanity lives and dies, had troubles. Such troubles. Still, it may just be the bubble this editor lives in, but things weren't entirely bad. Not by any means. Species came back from the brink of extinction. People treated one another with decency and respect, and tried to improve the world they lived in. And there were real, substantial reasons to believe that, even if things weren't great, they could get better, and might even be fixed one day. There was reason to hope. In amongst it all, remote space probes continued to fulfil the dreams of science fiction, visiting Mars, landing on comets and asteroids, and somewhere out there, a second unmanned spacecraft entered interstellar space. Voyager 2 followed its sister craft out beyond the sun's heliopause and into the great dark. It gave this reader chills. I may no longer believe humankind will go to the stars, but the dream continues to grip me. If 2018 was difficult for the world at large, it was no easier for the science fiction and fantasy worlds that fall within the remit of this book. As was alluded to last year, Disney Marvel held our attention in a death grip, making $7 billion at the box office along the way, with a bunch of sequels, prequels, and the like. The most popular movie of the year was Marvel's Black Panther, a film that put Afrofuturism, the exploration of the developing intersection of African/African diaspora culture with technology, on the big screen. And audiences loved it. It was one of the most vibrant and alive films Marvel have produced, and shone beside the comparatively stodgy Avengers: Infinity War, which dragged the whole Phase 3 of Marvel movies towards closure. Lighter fare held our attention too. Pixar's Incredibles 2 told possibly the most fun superhero story of the year. So many superhero stories. Deadpool 2 was foul-mouthed and hilarious, and Ant-Man and the Wasp was a delight. Arguably the best superhero movie of the year, though, came out at year's end. Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse was smart, adventurous, well-written, and had room to be playful in a way that was delightful. And it made money. They all made money. Such a lot of money. So too did the various television extensions of science fiction and fantasy universes. Star Trek returned to television with Star Trek Discovery, a darker, more dynamic Trek, with an excellent female lead in Sonequa Martin-Green, and a criminally underused Michelle Yeoh, who also shone in the hit movie Crazy Rich Asians. More Trek is coming in 2019, with a Patrick Stewart-led Next Generation spin-off. Doctor Who returned for a new season too, a mostly successful run through the universe with Jodie Whittaker in the titular role. The first woman cast as the Doctor, Whittaker was terrific and her fellow cast were solid, but they were let down by some very ordinary scripts. Audiences responded though, and the show was a ratings hit. There were so many others, from Daredevil to Jessica Jones, Black Lightning to Supergirl, The Magicians to American Gods, Lost in Space to Altered Carbon, that I couldn't keep track of them all. Was there a net effect of all of this torrent of visual SF and F? I don't know, but I felt fatigued by year's end. Everything has been or is being adapted to film or television. Everything's getting a sequel, and it's easy to feel worn out and disinterested. And yet, for every third-rate piece of extruded entertainment, there was something surprising and good. For every lacklustre and confusing Iron Fist, you could hope to find a smart and engaging show like Counterpart. And there's much, much, much more coming in 2019. How were things in the world of prose, science fiction and fantasy in 2018? The short stuff? Like most of the past few years, it was good and it was not good. There was the appearance of change, but possibly without much actual substantial change. If there were trends that I managed to discern, they weren't surprising ones. The once insular English language publishing world that this book is part of is more and more open to and aware of the rest of the world. Translated fiction is becoming more widely available through the efforts of dedicated editors, publishers, and translators who are determined to bring science fiction and fantasy written in languages other than English to our attention. The efforts to publish Chinese language science fiction especially stood out during the year. The same was true of Afrofuturist fiction, with major anthologies like Afro SF 3 and important magazines like Faya, bringing us some of the best fiction of the year. And there was a continuing openness to more perspectives in fiction, whether it be in important series like Bogie Talkotch's Transcendent, the year's best transgender speculative fiction, or standalone anthologies like Rivka Raphael and Tansy Rayner Roberts's Mother of Invention, or simply in the pages of almost every significant magazine or anthology published during the year. And the field, and by extension we as readers, were richer for it. There was change though. There's always change. Not every magazine that was there in January made it all the way to December. All of the major magazines did, but we lost Shimmer, Space and Time, and Mythic Delirium during 2018. Giganotosaurus appointed a new editor, but happily is continuing after a strong year, while Apex magazine announced that it would be discontinuing its print edition and going digital only, also after a very strong year. Nostalgia once again proved to be a risky business in magazine publishing. While 2017 saw the revival of the classic 80s science fiction magazine Omni, with one issue published late that year, no further issues have appeared to date. And similarly, Amazing Stories emerged again with a new issue launched in August at the World Science Fiction Convention in San Jose. But to date, no further issues have appeared and left this reader wondering if there's more to be done in boldly striking out for the future than in trying to revive what's past. However it went for individual publications, 2018 was a vibrant year for short fiction. Once again, as it has been for the entire life of this series, more short fiction was published than any one person or even small team of people could possibly read or even find. It's been some time since I've seen a reliable assessment of the number of pieces of original short science fiction and fiction published in the English language in any given year. And even that seemed unlikely to be accurate. In 2018, short fiction was published as standalone books and in anthologies, single author collections, magazines, promotional materials, blog posts, and podcasts, and was offered for sale, given away free, made available behind a paywall, or offered for subscription. There honestly didn't seem to be a limit to where you could find a new story, or how you could obtain one, and this was good. One thing that is becoming increasingly clear to me, though, is that writers get a substantial benefit from seeing their work published online, where readers can easily discover it, share it, and discuss it. The immediate ability to read a story and then tell friends, share it on social media, and so on, is materially shaping what work readers and editors hear about, how they respond to it, and what makes awards ballots. I'm not sure what this bodes for the future, but I wonder about it a lot. So, where were the best places to look for short fiction in 2018? As was the case in 2017, novella-length fiction continues to dominate. It remains true that there is nothing new about publishing novella-length fiction, and that almost all of the major novella publishers have been active at some stage in the past two decades. But these past few years have been different. Novellas are getting attention as standalone books in ways they rarely did before, garnering significant sales, widespread reviews, and places on awards ballots. The leader here remains Tor.com Publishing, now in its fifth year. During 2018, they published hugely successful books like Martha Wells's Artificial Condition, Exit Strategy, and Rogue Protocol, Nnedi Okorafor's Binti, The Night Masquerade, Seanan McGuire's Beneath the Sugar Sky, and critically acclaimed books by P. Jalay Clark, Caitlin R. Kiernan, Ian MacDonald, Brooke Bolander, and Kelly Robson. Robson's Gods, Monsters and the Lucky Peach is my personal pick for the best science fiction novella of the year, a bright, effervescent time travel adventure. While I also loved Kiernan's powerful and compelling Black Helicopters, The Director's Cut, Ian MacDonald's moving gay time travel romance, Time Was, and Jai Yang's The Descent of Monsters. All would appear in this book, but for length. Full disclosure requires me to state that I work for Tor.com Publishing and acquired the books by MacDonald and Kiernan. Tor.com wasn't alone in publishing major novellas in 2018. Aliette de Baudard published two fine tales at this length in 2018. In The Vanisher's Palace, Jabberwocky, is a dark, gender-fluid recasting of Beauty and the Beast, with multidimensional dragons that just falls over into novel length and should be on awards ballots in 2019. Also wonderful was her novella from Subterranean, The Tea Master and The Detective, a shuya tale of murder and intrigue. Magazines featured several excellent novellas, with highlights including Carolyn Ives Gilman's dark science fiction tale Umber Night at Clark's World, Greg Egan's Three Attica for Asimovs, Juliet Wade's The Persistence of Blood, also at Clark's World, who had a great year in 2018, and Kate Marshall's We Ragged Few at the outstanding Beneath Ceaseless Skies. Other standouts included Nicola Griffith's So Lucky, FSG, Peter Watts's The Freeze Frame Revolution, Tachyon, Janine Webb's The Dragon's Child, PS Publishing, Cynthia Ward's The Adventures of Dux Ballorum, Aqueduct, and Adam Roberts's The Lake Boy, New Con Press. All repay your attention. 2018 was a really interesting year for original anthologies. As a caveat, I edited Infinity's End, an anthology of science fiction stories set in far distant places from Solaris, that featured stories by Kelly Robson, Naomi Kreitzer, Seanan McGuire, Alistair Reynolds, Justina Robson, and others. Given I can pretend little objectivity on the subject, I'll simply say it's a book that I'm proud of and recommend. The title of Best Anthology of 2018, though, belongs to one of three books. Dominic Parisienne and Nava Wolf took up the challenge of Holly Black and Justine Larbalestier's playful Zombies vs. Unicorns, and gave us their own science fiction and fantasy mashup, Robots vs. Fairies, which featured some of the year's very best work, including stories by Annalee Newitz, Jeffrey Ford, Ken Liu, Lavi Tidar, Catherine M. Valenti, and others. Equally good, and perhaps even a little better, was Ellen O. and Elise Chapman's remarkable 1,000 Beginnings and Endings, a diverse selection of stories recasting tales from folklore and mythology, which featured major work by Aliette de Baudard, Alyssa Wong, Roshani Chokshi, and Renee Ogdier. And then there was the big one, the final book of new stories edited by Gardner Dozois, The Book of Magic, followed on from last year's The Book of Swords, and featured what Gardner himself would have called core fantasy, from John Crowley, Garth Nix, Megan Lindholm, KJ Parker, Andy Duncan, Lavi Tidar, and others, and is filled with the good stuff. All of these are worthwhile, contain essential stories, and belong on your bookshelf. Look for them come awards time in 2019. Of the year's remaining anthologies, I'd recommend Wade Rausch's excellent 12 Tomorrows, the latest instalment in the MIT Press series, which included outstanding fiction from Elizabeth Baer, S.L. Huang, Ken Liu, and others, and was probably the best science fiction anthology of the year. It was closely followed by Ian Waitz's 2001, An Odyssey in Words, Greg Witte, Hugh Howey, and Christine Yant's Resist, Tales from a Future Worth Fighting Against. Lisa Jacek's fine historical retrospective, The Future is Female. Russell B. Farr's novella collection, Aurum. Bill Campbell and Francesco Verso's Future Fiction, New Dimensions in International Science Fiction. Susan Law and Lucas K. Forrest's Shades Within Us. Rivka Raphael and Tansy Rayner Roberts's Mother of Invention, and Sheldon Teitelbaum's Zion's Fiction, a treasury of Israeli speculative literature. From the first moment I sat down to write one of these retrospective essays, I've found myself saying it was a good year for collections. How, honestly, could it not be? There is so much short fiction published and so many new and exciting writers entering the field that it seems impossible that we wouldn't be drowning in outstanding books. And we were once again in 2018. Andy Duncan's An Agent of Utopia is his first new collection in 6 years and his first published in his home country since 2000. And appropriately, it featured two new stories that stand among the best of the year, including one featured here. Duncan actually had a remarkable year, publishing four new stories, all recommendable, and all confirming him as a writer to be treasured. Small Beer published two other extraordinary collections during the year. Vandana Singh's Ambiguity Machines and Other Stories, and Abby May Otis's Alien Virus Love Disaster were urgent, essential work and stand as a testament both to their writers and to the perspicacity and good taste of the editors at Small Beer. At this year's World Science Fiction Convention, N.K. Jemisin's work was awarded the Hugo Award for Best Novel for the third year in a row. She has sold more than 1 million books, and her fiction is being adapted for the big and small screens. Until now, her short fiction has, comparatively speaking, been under-recognised. But How Long Till Black Future Month is a powerful, engaging, persuasive, and at times angry work that shows a writer at the height of their powers, working out how to write short fiction and how to do it well. One of four originals in the book is reprinted here, but it could have been almost any of them. Also essential was Kelly Barnhill's Dreadful Young Ladies and Other Stories, Priya Sharma's wonderful All the Fabulous Beasts, Nana Kwame Adjei-Brenya's Friday Black, Catherine M. Valenti's The Future is Blue, Rich Larson's Tomorrow Factory, Collected Fiction, and K.J. Parker's The Father of Lies. I have a real soft spot for the short fiction of Caitlin R. Kiernan, and she delivered two major collections this year. There was the highly limited Cthulhu-related collection, Houses Under the Sea, and the latest in her series of collections for Subterranean, which mostly collects stories from Sirenia Digest, The Dinosaur Tourist. It's extraordinary work. What this bookshelf of short story collections shows is that there is a lot of incredible reading out there, and more to come. I don't normally mention this, but during 2018, we lost some of our greatest and most beloved creators, including Ursula K. Le Guin, Jack Ketchum, Victor Milan, Peter Nichols, Kate Wilhelm, Mary Rosenblum, Karen Anderson, David Bischoff, Christopher Stasheff, Harlan Ellison, Michael Scott Rohan, David J. Willoughby, Pat Lupoff, Dave Duncan, Stan Lee, and William Goldman. Perhaps most relevantly, though, we lost my friend and collaborator, Gardner Dozois, who passed away unexpectedly in May. He left behind a towering legacy, a body of fiction to be envied, bibliography of anthologies that both changed and recorded the history of science fiction and fantasy, a time-editing Asimov's that stands with any great editor's run at any magazine, and countless writers whose lives and work he touched and made better. He will be missed. And so, the end and a new beginning. The book you're about to read is the final volume in the Best Science Fiction and Fantasy of the Year anthology series. I'm deeply saddened by this, but also incredibly grateful to my editors and publishers over the past 13 years who have supported these books, and am more indebted than I can say to each and every writer who allowed me to reprint their work for you to enjoy. But times change. We move on. For all that this series is now complete, I'm far from finished trying to bring you the best short fiction of the year. Next year, I'll be assembling the very best science fiction stories of the year in a brand new anthology series, Year's Best SF, for a brand new publisher. I am excited and looking forward to that challenge, to the chance to refine my focus and bring you the science fiction I love. I hope you'll look out for me in 2020 when the time comes. For now, though, one last time with feeling. Here are the very best short science fiction and fantasy stories of the year. I hope you love them as much as I do. Jonathan Strahan, Perth, Western Australia, December 2018.
Mother Tongues by S. Cho Yi Lu. Thank you very much, you say, concluding the oral portion of the exam. You gather your things and exit back into the brightly lit hallway. Photos line the walls, the Eiffel Tower, the Great Wall of China, Machu Picchu. The sun shines on each destination, the images brimming with wonder. You pause before the Golden Gate Bridge. Yoga Jodala, the attendant says. You look up. His blonde hair is as standardized as his Mandarin, as impeccable as his crisp shirt and tie. You've just proven your aptitude in English, but hearing Mandarin still puts you at ease in the way only a mother tongue does. You smile at the attendant, murmuring a brief thanks as you make your way down the hall. You turn right and enter a consultation room. The room is small but welcoming, potted plants adding a dash of green to the otherwise plain creams and browns of the furniture and walls. A literature rack stands to one side, brochures in all kinds of languages tucked into its pockets, creating a mosaic of sights and symbols. The section just on English boasts multiple flags, names of different varieties overlaid on the designs. U.S. English, standard. U.K. English, received pronunciation. Singaporean English, standard. Nigerian English, standard. Emblazoned on every brochure is the logo of the Linguistic Grading Society of America, a round seal with a side view of a head showing the vocal tract. You pick up a standard U.S. English brochure and take a seat in one of the middle chairs opposite the mahogany desk that sits before the window. The brochure provides a brief overview of the grading system. Your eyes linger on the A grade description. Speaker engages on a wide variety of topics with ease. Phonology is standard. Speaker has a broad vocabulary. You take a quick peek at the dictionary on your phone. Phonology, linguistic sound systems. You file the word away to remember later. The door opens. A woman wearing a blazer and pencil skirt walks in, her heels clacking against the hardwood floor, her curled hair bouncing with every step. You stand to greet her and catch a breath of her perfume. Diana Moss, she says, shaking your hand. Her name tag also displays her job title, language broker. Jiawen Liu, you reply. Diana takes a seat across from you. As you sit, you smooth out your skirt, straighten your sleeves. Is English all right? Diana asks. I can get an interpreter in if you'd prefer to discuss in Mandarin. English is fine, you reply. You clasp your hands together as you eye Diana's tablet. She swipes across the screen and taps a few spots, her crimson nails stark against the black barrel of the stylus. Great, she says. Well, let's dive right in, shall we? I'm showing that you've been in the U.S. for, let's see, 15 years now? Wow, that's quite a while. You nod. Yes. And you used to be an economics professor in China, is that correct? You nod again. Yes. Fantastic, Diana says. Just one moment as I load the results. The scores for the oral portion always take a moment to come in. Your palms are clammy, sweaty. Diana twirls the stylus, and you can't help feeling a little dizzy as you watch. Finally, Diana props the tablet up and turns it toward you. I'm pleased to inform you that your English has tested at a C grade, she says with a broad smile. Your heart sinks. Surely there's been some kind of error, but no. The letter is unmistakable, bright red on the screen, framed with flourishes and underlined with signatures. No doubt the certificate is authentic. Diana's perfume is too heady now, sickly sweet. The room is too bright, suffocating as the walls shrink in around you. I, you say, then take a breath. I was expecting better. For what it's worth, your scores on the written and analytical portions of the test were excellent, better than many native speakers of English in the U.S., Diana says. Then what brought my score down? Our clients are looking for a certain profile of English, Diana says, apologetic. If you're interested in retesting, I can refer you to an accent reduction course. I've seen many prospective sellers go through the classes and get recertified at a higher grade. She doesn't mention how much the accent reduction course costs, but from your own research, you know it's more than you can afford. Ms. Liu, Diana says. She's holding out a tissue. You accept it and dab at your eyes. Why don't you tell me what you're trying to accomplish? Maybe we can assist you. You take in a deep breath as you crumple the tissue into your fist. My daughter Lillian just got into Stanford, early decision, you say. Congratulations. Yes, but we can't afford it. C-grade English sells at only a fraction of A-grade English. You'd rather keep your English than sell it for such a paltry sum that would barely put a dent in textbooks and supplies, never mind tuition and housing. There are other tracks you can consider, Diana says, her voice gentle. Your daughter can go to a community college, for instance, and then transfer out to Stanford again. You shake your head. Community colleges in the San Gabriel Valley are among the top in the nation, Diana continues. There's no shame in it. You're unconvinced. What if she can't transfer out? You and Lillian can't risk that. A good education at a prestigious school is far too important for securing Lillian's future. No. Better to take this opportunity that's already been given to her and go with it. Diana stands and goes over to the literature rack. She flips through a few brochures. You know, Diana says as she strides back to you. China's really hot right now with their new open-door policy. Lots of people are clamoring to invest there. I have people calling me all the time, asking if I have A-grade Mandarin. She sets a brochure down on the desk and sits back in the executive chair across from you. Have you considered selling your Mandarin? You trace your hands over the brochure, feeling the embossed logo. China's flag cascades down to a silhouette of Beijing's skyline. You read the simplified characters printed on the brochure, your eyes skimming over them so much more quickly than you skim over English. How much? You ask. Diana leans in. A-grade Mandarin is going for as much as $800,000 these days. Your heart skips a beat. That would be enough to cover Lillian's college, with maybe a little bit left over. It's a tantalizing number. But the thought of going without Mandarin gives you pause. It's the language you think in, the language that's close to your heart in the way English is not. It's more integral to who you are than any foreign tongue. English you could go without. Lillian's Mandarin is good enough to help you translate your way around what you need. But Mandarin? I'm not sure, you say, setting down the brochure. Selling my Mandarin. It's a big decision for sure, Diana says. She pulls a small silver case out from the pocket of her blazer and opens it with a click. But if you change your mind, she slides a sleek business card across the table. Call me. You decide to go for a week without Mandarin just to see if you can do it. At times, the transition feels seamless. So many of the people in the San Gabriel Valley are bilingual, you get by fine with only English. Your job as a librarian in the local public library is a little trickier, though. Most of your patrons speak English, but a few do not. You decide to shake your head and send the Mandarin-only speakers over to your coworker, who also speaks Mandarin. But when lunchtime comes around, she sits beside you in the break room and gives you a curious look. 为什么今天把顾客转给我? She asks. You figure that you might as well tell her the truth. I want to sell my Mandarin. I'm seeing what it would be like without it.
卖你的普通话,
she responds, an incredulous look on her face.
神经病.
You resent being called crazy, even if some part of you wonders if this is a foolish decision. Still, you soldier on for the rest of the week in English. Your coworker isn't always there to cover for you when there are Mandarin-speaking patrons, and sometimes you break your vow and say a few quick sentences in Mandarin to them, but the rest of the time you're strict with yourself. Conversation between you and Lillian flows smoothly for the most part. Normally, you speak in a combination of English and Mandarin with her, and she responds mostly in English. When you switch to English only, Lillian doesn't seem to notice. On the occasions when she does speak to you in Mandarin, you hold back and respond in English too. Your roles reversed. At ATMs, you choose English instead of Chinese. When you run errands, thank you replaces xiexie. It's only until Friday rolls around and you're grocery shopping with your mother that not speaking in Mandarin becomes an issue. You're in the supermarket doing your best to ignore the Chinese characters labeling the produce. So many things that you don't know the word for in English. But you recognize them by sight, and that's good enough. All you need is to be able to pick out what you need. If you look at things out of the corner of your eye, squint a little bit, you can pretend to be illiterate in Chinese, pretend to navigate things only by memory instead of language. You can cheat with your mother a little bit. You know enough Cantonese to have a halting conversation with her, as she knows both Cantonese and Mandarin, but it's frustrating. Your pauses between words lengthy as you try to remember words and tones.
干嘛今天说广东话?
Your mother asks in Mandarin. She's pushing the shopping cart, she insists, even when you offer, and one of the wheels is squeaking. She hunches over the handle, but her eyes are bright. You reply in Cantonese, except it's not exactly that you want to speak Cantonese, you have to, for now. You don't know how to capture the nuance of everything you're going through in Cantonese either, so you leave it at that. Your mother gives you a look, but she doesn't bring it up again and indulges you, speaking Cantonese, as the two of you go around the supermarket and pile the shopping cart high with produce, meat, and fish. You load the car with groceries and help your mother into the passenger seat. As you adjust the mirrors, your mother speaks again.
你在担心什么?
She asks. Startled, you look over at her. She's peering at you, scrutinizing you. You can never hide anything from her. Of course, she can read the worry on your face, the tension in your posture. Of course, she knows something's wrong. You respond, trying to communicate the weight on your shoulders.
什么决定?
Your mother replies. You can't find the words to express the choice you have to make in Cantonese. Every time you grasp for the right syllables, they come back in Mandarin. Frustrated, you switch back to Mandarin and reply.
我为了去送Lillian上大学，想卖我的普通话。
You expect your mother to scold you, to tell you about the importance of your heritage and language. She's always been proud of who she is, where she's from. She's always been the first to teach you about your own culture. But instead, her expression softens, and she puts a hand over yours, her wrinkled skin warm against your skin.
哎,姐姐,没有喊的办法吗?
Your nickname is so tender on her tongue. But you thought through all other avenues. You don't want Lillian to take out loans and be saddled with so much debt like your friend's children. You don't want her to bear such a burden her entire life, not while you're still paying off debts too. You can't rely on Lillian's father to provide for her, not after he left your family and took what little money you had. And although Lillian's been doing her best to apply for scholarships, they're not enough. You shake your head. The two of you sit in silence as you start the car and drive back to your mother's place. The sun sets behind you, casting a brilliant glow over the earth, washing the sky from orange to blue. As you crest over a hill, the sparkling lights of the city below glitter in the darkness, showing you a million lives, a million dreams. When you get to your mother's house, you only have one question to ask her.
如果 你需要做同样的决定,
you say.
你也会这样做吗?
You don't know what it would have been like if you were in Lillian's shoes, if your mother had to make the same decision as you. But as your mother smiles at you, sadness tinging the light in her eyes, the curve of her lips. You know she understands.
Dangran, she says. Of course.
The waiting room is much starker than the consultation room you were in before. The seats are less comfortable, the temperature colder. You're alone, except for a single TV playing world news at a low volume. You read the paperwork, doing your best to understand the details of the procedure. For all you pride yourself on your English, though, there are still many terms you don't understand completely. The company's proprietary algorithms iterate through near-infinite permutations of sentences, extracting a neural map. The cognitive load on the brain will cause the applicant to experience a controlled stroke, and the applicant's memory of the language will be erased. Common side effects include temporary disorientation, nausea. Less common side effects include partial aphasia of non-target languages and retrograde amnesia. Applicant agrees to hold company harmless. You flip over to the Chinese version of the contract, and while some of the terms raise concern in you, you've already made your decision and can't back out now. You scan the rest of the agreement and sign your name at the bottom. The lab is clinical, streamlined, with a large, complicated-looking machine taking up most of the room. An image of the brain appears on a black panel before you. Before we begin, the technician says, do you have any questions? You nod as you toy with your hospital gown. Will I be able to learn Mandarin again? Potentially, though it won't be as natural or easy as the first time around. Learning languages is usually harder than losing them. You swallow your nervousness. Do it for Lillian. Why can't you make a copy of the language instead of erasing it? The technician smiles ruefully. As our current technology stands, the imaging process has the unfortunate side effect of suppressing neurons as it replicates them. You can't help but wonder cynically if the reason why the neurons have to be suppressed is to create artificial scarcity, to inflate demand in the face of limited supply. But if that scarcity is what allows you to put Lillian through college, you'll accept it. The technician hooks electrodes all over your head. There's a faint hum, setting your teeth on edge. As the technician finishes placing the last of the electrodes on your head, certain parts of the brain on the panel light up, ebbing and flowing. A small chunk in the back active. You try to recall the areas of the brain from biology classes in university, and while different parts of your brain start to light up, you still don't remember the names of any of the regions. The technician flips a couple switches, then types a few commands. The sensation that crawls over you is less of a shock than a tingling across your scalp. Thoughts flash through your mind too fast for you to catch them. You glance up at the monitor and see light firing between the areas the technician pointed out, paths carving through the brain and flowing back and forth. The lights flash faster and faster until they become a single blur. And as you watch, your world goes white. The technician and nurse keep you at the institute for a few hours to monitor your side effects. Slight disorientation, but that fades as the time goes by. They ask if you have anyone picking you up. You insist that you're fine taking public transportation by yourself, and the technician and nurse relent. The accountant pays you the first installment of the money, and soon you're taking the steps down from the institute's main doors, a cool breeze whipping at your hair. The bus ride home is strange. As you go from West Los Angeles toward the San Gabriel Valley, the English-dominating billboards and signs starts to give way to Chinese. Although you can still understand the balance of the characters, know when they're backwards in the rearview mirrors, you can't actually read them. They're no more than shapes, familiar ones, but indecipherable ones. You suck down a deep breath and will your heart to stop beating so quickly.
It will take time to adjust to this, just as it took time to adjust to being thrown into a world of English when you first immigrated to the United States. A corner of the check sticks out of your purse. You'll be okay. Your family is celebrating Chinese New Year this weekend. You drive with Lillian over to your mother's senior living apartment. You squeeze in through the door while carrying a bag of fruit. Your mother is cooking in the tiny kitchenette, the space barely big enough for the both of you. She's wearing the frilly blue apron with embroidered teddy bears on it, and you can't help but smile as you inhale the scent of all the food frying and simmering on the stove. Bong mong, you say in Cantonese. It's one of the few words you can remember. As the days passed, you realized that some of your Cantonese had been taken too, its roots intertwined and excised with your Mandarin. Your mother says something you don't understand, gesturing toward the couch. You and Lillian sit down. A period drama plays on the television. The subtitles go by too fast for you to match sound to symbol. Lillian idly taps away on her phone. A few moments pass like this, your gaze focused on the television as you see if you can pick up something, anything at all. Sometimes you catch a phrase that jogs something in your memory, but before you can recall what the phrase means, the sound of it and its meaning are already gone. Lillian gets up and you follow suit. The small dining room table has been decked out with all kinds of food, glistening ruby red shrimp with caramelized onions, braised fish, stir-fried lotus root with sausage, sauteed vegetables. You wish you could tell your mother how good it looks. Instead, you can only flash her a smile and hope she understands. Your mother says something you don't understand. Lillian digs in, picking up shrimp with her chopsticks. You scold her and remind her of her manners. But she said I could go ahead. Lillian says, still, you reply. You place some food on your mother's plate first, then Lillian's. Finally, you set some food on your own plate. Only after your mother's eaten do you take a bite. Lillian converses with your mother. Her Mandarin sounds a little stilted, starting and stopping, thick with an American accent. But her enthusiasm expresses itself in the vibrant conversation that flows around you. You stay quiet, shrinking into yourself as your mother laughs, as Lillian smiles. You're seated between Lillian and your mother. The gap across the table from you is a little too big, spacing the three of you unevenly around the table. As the syllables cascade around you, you swear the spaces between you and your mother, between you and Lillian, grow larger and larger. After dinner, as your mother washes up the dishes. Again, she refuses your help. You and Lillian watch the spring gala playing on the television. An invited pop star from the U.S., the only white person on the stage, sings a love ballad in Mandarin. You don't need to know what she's saying to tell that she doesn't have an American accent. I bet she bought her Mandarin, Lillian says. It's an offhanded comment, but still, you try to see if you can detect any disgust in her words. Is that so bad? You ask. I don't know. It just seems a little appropriative, you know? You don't know. Lillian doesn't know. You were planning on telling her the instant you came home, but you didn't know how to bring it up. And now, you want to keep your sacrifice a secret. Because it's not about you. It was never about you. But it's only a matter of time before Lillian finds out. You don't know how she'll react. Will she understand? Lillian rests her head on your shoulder. You pull her close. Your girl who's grown up so fast. You try to find the words to tell her what you'd do for her, how important it is that she has a good future, how much you love her, and want only the best for her. But all you have is silence. Olivia's Table by Alyssa Wong. Olivia blew into town with the storm and headed straight for the Grand Silver Hotel. Pots and containers of sauces and marinade clattered in the trunk of her Toyota, packed in with the rest of the groceries she'd brought from Phoenix. The evening sky hung heavy with dark clouds, but the shrinking Arizona sun still burned her arms through the car windows. Bisden was one of those mining towns that had sprung up in the 1800s, flourished for a while, and then all but died once the silver ran out. Now the town made its money from the tourists who trickled in, hoping to see two things: a real Wild West ghost town and one of the most haunted historical sites in the Southwest. After a childhood of making the trip down from Phoenix, Olivia barely needed her GPS to guide her. She drove past the sparse Palo Verdes lining the old shop fronts. Outside, the wind whipped up sharp clouds of dust and stone shards, sending them sweeping down the barren red dirt road that ran through Bisden's town square. The air carried a light brown tint, and Olivia squinted to see through it. In front of a clapboard saloon, two reenactment actors in full period dress were toughing out the approaching dust storm, fingering the pistols hanging at their hips. Most of the town's tourists had migrated inside. A few hung back to watch them, shading their eyes or filming on their phones. And then there were the ghosts, dozens of them, clustered around the tourists and swaying in the wind like feather grass. A couple were dressed in fine clothes, long skirts and blouses buttoned to the throat, cravats tucked into tight waistcoats, but most were dressed in working clothes, wide-brimmed hats, sturdy trousers, loose shirts. Only some of them were white folks. All bore signs of trauma. Gunshots punched a cluster of holes through one gentleman's torso, and a cluster of women hanging back by the saloon had burned, blackened bodies, the remains of their dresses drifting around them in ashes. Olivia sighed. They were right in front of the Grand Silver Hotel, too, figured. She slung her backpack over her shoulder and pocketed her phone. Her braid was coming loose, but she ignored it. After locking her car, Olivia pulled out the long envelope of paper talismans that her grandma had written years ago. She slapped one over each of the car windows, and the coppery scent of magic sparked in the air. The sky rumbled overhead as she retrieved a pack of saran wrap and taped sheets of plastic over the talismans. If this worked, the talismans would keep ghosts away from the car, and the saran wrap would keep the rain away from the talismans. It would work, she thought firmly. It worked for her mom all the times they'd made the trip together, and even though she wasn't there now, Olivia had watched her ward her car like this for years. No time for doubts. She headed for the hotel, past the reenactment actors and tourists. She had to push her way through the ghosts. Their bodies felt more solid than they did the rest of the year, and fabric brushed her hands as she edged through the crowd. "Excuse me," she muttered. A pair of Hopi women glanced down at her from beneath the brims of their hats, turning to make room for her to squeeze by. A cluster of Chinese miners, their bodies broken and smashed. A cave-in, she thought. An accident. Watched her, unmoving from a distance. None of the tourists seemed to see the ghosts, staring through them at the girl weaving her way through empty air. The Grand Silver Hotel rose three stories into the air, clinging to its last shreds of grandeur. Inside, new light bulbs shone in old fixtures, and the tatty carpet crunched under Olivia's sneakers. Like every other establishment in town, the Grand Silver kept its head above water by advertising its very own ghost. An oil painting of the Wailing Lady hung on the wall above the reception desk, and a rotating rack of postcards, most of them reproductions of the painting, spun lazily by the elevator door. The older woman behind the desk smiled as Olivia approached. Her name tag read, Renee. "Welcome to the Grand Silver Hotel. How may we help you today?" "I'm here for the Ghost Festival," said Olivia. Her voice sounded too loud in the nearly empty lobby. She hated listening to herself speak. Talking, period, wasn't easy for her. "I need a room for tonight and tomorrow night, and some help getting things out of my car." Renee brightened. "Of course. The Ghost Festival is tomorrow night, and it's one of Bisden's big attractions. Now, there are a few other groups of tourists who made the trip here to see it, so you won't be alone. It's perfectly safe, but we do ask that everyone stay inside and keep a healthy distance from the ghosts."
"I'm not a tourist," Olivia said. "I'm here to cook the banquet for the festival."
She reached for her driver's license, and her student ID slipped out first. She caught it before it hit the ground.
"You've worked with my mom before, Amory Chang."
The receptionist squinted.
"You're Exorcist Chang's daughter, are you? You do look a bit like her."
It was nice of her to lie, thought Olivia.
"She helped us out for years. Every summer, on the night when the ghosts come out to walk among the living. And her cooking, of course, was sublime."
"Thank you," Olivia wanted to say, but the words wouldn't come. Renee didn't seem to notice.
"We're looking forward to having you for the Ghost Festival. Exorcist Chang was always a wonder to watch. Excellent showmanship, and her work kept the town safe for years."
As Olivia checked into her room, Renee paused.
"By the way, our wailing lady is getting unruly. Could you look into fixing that up or finding a replacement? It's been almost 10 years since your mother tended to our ghost."
The wailing lady's painting hung serenely on the wall. In it was an ample young woman wearing a wedding dress and a veil that obscured her face. A jilted, suicidal bride whose weeping could still sometimes be heard late at night. Not very original. "I'll look into it," said Olivia. Renee and the two folks working at the hotel, a maid and a young man who was probably her son, helped lug Olivia's vats of soy sauce and marinade from her car and into the hotel kitchen. Rice, cooking utensils, and paper bag after paper bag of different kinds of meat followed. Pickings at the Bisden supermarket were slim, so she'd brought everything she could fit into the Toyota's backseat and trunk. As they carried the groceries inside, Olivia caught sight of the ghosts out front. The reenactment actors were gone, and now the ghosts stared, as one, at Olivia and the hotel employees. The air smelled like approaching rain. She walked faster. After sussing out the kitchen, on the small side, though all the kitchens at the old Bisden hotels were, Olivia checked her phone. No signal, no internet. Though there were a couple of password-locked hotspots from the shops nearby. The Grand Silver had its own router, and Renee gave Olivia the password along with a long, old-fashioned metal key.
"You'll be in room 309, she said.
Olivia spent the next couple hours in that kitchen, cutting, testing, prepping. It was night by the time she finished. When she made it upstairs to her room, she crouched on the floor by the bed and set out packet after packet of incense and joss paper. She hoped she brought enough. Enough incense, enough food. No, it would be enough. She unpacked a small ceramic bowl and emptied a handful of dried orange peel into it, and then she lit a match over it. Once her mom had taught her that the smoke from burning orange peel would keep the ghosts away, it had never failed her. Olivia hesitated. The flame licked down the match, chasing her fingers. After a second, she shook it out. Wind rattled the windows as she settled into bed, the sounds of faint footsteps upstairs and a woman sobbing through the floorboards chased her into her dreams. It had rained during every ghost festival that Olivia could remember. On the 7th month of her mom's calendar and the 8th month on her dad's, Mom would pack the minivan with food and head down south for a couple of days, leaving Olivia in Dad and Grandma's care. It was monsoon season, and torrential rains flooded the roads and the stony washes out behind the houses. But when the skies cleared, Mom would return with an empty trunk and a check for more money than she made in half a year. For a time, she didn't tell Olivia where she went or what she did. But the year Olivia turned 8, Mom loaded her into the back seat next to the paper bags of groceries and drove her to Bisden for the first time. "Come with Mama," she said. Back then, her short black hair was only faintly laced with silver, and she still looked healthy. "I need you to help me with the Ghost Festival this year." The drive was several hours long, and by the time they reached the tiny town, sunset was approaching. So was a storm, a desert monsoon that crawled inexorably across the horizon. That night, they checked into the Grand Silver, although in the coming years, they would rotate from hotel to hotel, collecting paychecks from many grateful proprietors. Every hotel in town wanted the chance to host the festival and attract the bulk of that year's tourists. Mom told Olivia that when her own mom and the long line of Chang women before her had cooked for the Ghost Festival in this country and in their countries before that, they'd rarely stayed in a place for more than a year. "Different ghosts are tied to different spaces, Olivia," Mom said as they got ready for bed. The lamp cast a warm glow across her face. "Sometimes they form attachments to specific places, and sometimes other people bind them there and they can't leave. Moving the banquet means bringing food to folks who missed their chance to eat the year before. Good service is all about being considerate of others." Mom spent the entire night and then the next day cooking and prepping, and she had Olivia help her as often as she could. Olivia stood on a little metal stool and cut vegetables. Her knife cuts were careful and even under her mom's strict tutelage. Occasionally, she peered out the windows, watching the tourists run through the rain, their eyes growing huge and round, even from this distance, whenever they glimpsed one of the ghosts. "They're scared of them," Mom told her as she set out a pair of bamboo steamers. "Right now, they can see them."
"Can't they see the ghosts all the time?" she asked.
"Not like you and I can. The festival is when ghosts are most themselves instead of what the living want them to be. Not everyone will like what they see tonight." When her arms grew tired, Mom sent her out of the kitchen to take breaks. The long banquet table that Mom had requested from the hotel was set up on the front porch. She crawled under it and watched the rain slosh down the road in growing streams, swirling with red-brown dirt until the daylight faded and the electric lights came on. Her Game Boy. She'd forgotten it in the car. Olivia didn't have an umbrella, but she ran out into the rain anyway, letting it beat at her through her clothes. It only rained for about 2 weeks each year, and the cool droplets hitting her face filled her with giddy energy. She sprinted down the street toward her mom's car, splashing deliberately in the biggest pools of water she could find. Halfway down the darkening street, a voice stopped her. "You're not from here." Olivia turned sharply. A ghost stood under the awning of the Bisden General Store, leaning against a post. She wore a cotton shirt and trousers like many of the other folks who'd worked on the railroad when they were alive. There weren't many women among the Chinese ghosts, but this one was a girl, with deep brown hair like Olivia's and a small mouth and dark eyes like Olivia's. She looked a little older than Olivia, but not nearly as old as Olivia's mom. "Did someone lose you?" said the ghost. "Nobody lost me," said Olivia. "I came to get my Game Boy." She came a little closer under the awning, and the ghost didn't shrink back. When Olivia reached out to touch her sleeve, her hand passed through. "What's your name?" "Mei Ling," said the ghost. She sounded amused. From this distance, Olivia could see that her legs were mangled, the way a number of other Chinese ghosts who died in construction accidents were. "My ma calls me Sadie, though." "I'm Olivia," said Olivia. "My grandma gave me a Chinese name, too, but my dad doesn't like me using it." She'd overheard her dad talking with her grandma one night when she was very little.
"What will she do when the other kids tease her at school?" he'd said.
Olivia didn't tell him that the other kids teased her anyway, name or no name. "I don't know what a Game Boy is," said the ghost. "But why don't I walk with you while you get it?" An alarm bell in Olivia's head began to ring. "Don't talk to strangers," Mom had said over and over. "And don't trust the ghosts, especially not during the Ghost Festival." "No," she said. "I'm okay. It's just over there." But the ghost followed her. Olivia began to run faster, and the creak of the ghost's ruined ankles grew louder and louder as the night got darker. The rain pounded down around them. The water rushed across the ground in rising torrents, with no gutters to guide it away from the street. Where was the car? It was dark, and the electric lights seemed so dim, and the ghost was behind her, lurching forward, moving too fast. Her foot slipped out from under her, and she fell backwards into the water,
Her head cracked hard against a stone, and the flash flood pulled her, rolling and gasping, down the street and onto her face. She inhaled a lungful of water. Olivia choked and tried to push herself up, but her palms slid on the loose gravel and her hands slipped out from under her. She was drowning. 2 weeks of rain a year, and this was how she'd die. When she came back as a ghost, would her lungs be full of water forever? Olivia reached out blindly, and someone grabbed her arm. The ghost hauled her out of the water. When she rubbed Olivia's back as Olivia coughed, her hand was solid and warm, all the way down to her broken fingers. Her cotton work clothing was soaked through. Olivia's head was bright with pain. Mei Ling lifted her and held her close to her chest. The ghost had no heartbeat. And then they were running, splashing through the rising water, headed back to the town square. The last thing Olivia saw were the stuccoed walls of the Grand Silver and the hordes of ghosts descending upon her mother's banquet table, their swarming, newly substantial bodies rippling in the moonlight. Olivia woke too early, her heart pounding loud in her ears. The roof rattled like someone was upending stones on it. The muted roar of torrential rain surrounded her, and when she pushed back the curtains, she saw that the street was full of rushing water, just as it had been all those years ago. No living people were out and about, not even the actors from yesterday, but ghosts, so many of them, almost too many to count, huddled under porch roofs and awnings, their bodies all clumped together away from the rain. Overhead, the sobbing had stopped. Last night, through the haze of half-swallowed dreams, the woman's voice had sounded familiar. Olivia listened carefully, but she could hear nothing but the storm. She checked her phone for missed calls and found that there were none. No phone service. Right. But there was internet. So she emailed her dad. "I made it to Bisden safely, cooking all today. I'll be home soon. Love you. Don't forget to eat." Too late, she remembered that her mom used to sign off all her texts and emails the same way. But she'd already hit send. She bit her lip, then turned away to pull on her jeans. Despite the early hour and pouring rain, the ghosts on the street were already out in full force. She walked past them, and their heads followed her on skinny, starved necks, rotating like owls. The full moon was a brief imprint in the sky, barely visible through a gap in the darkened clouds. As Olivia headed for her car, the boy who'd helped her move her supplies into the kitchen ran after her. "Hey," he said breathlessly. "Mom asked me to help you if you needed anything." Olivia looked at him. He looked about her age, maybe 17 at most. She couldn't remember his name. "I'm just going grocery shopping," she said. "I'll help you carry things if you want. I don't mind," he grinned. "I'm Carlos." He did look strong, Olivia conceded. His arms and back were well muscled. When he smiled, he had cute dimples. If she had been interested in men, she might have found him attractive. "I'm Olivia," she said. "I'm going to buy a lot of stuff, though." "I figured. I didn't think ghosts would eat a lot, but apparently they do." He didn't seem bothered by the rain or by the ghosts that watched them from the awnings. But then he didn't seem to see the ghosts at all. The best thing about the Bisden supermarket, Olivia decided, was that it was cheap. She headed straight for the back counter and bought 2 dozen fresh fish. These ones were dead, not as fresh as the live ones swimming in tanks at the Chinese market back home, but they would do. She loaded her cart up with fresh produce, green onions, carrots, garlic, herbs. 4 crates of oranges. It was too bad that Bisden didn't have a Costco. Carlos talked a lot, but he did hold up his end of the bargain. He carried all of her groceries and helped load them into her car. He told her all about his schooling. He was a junior, 1 year younger than her. His aspirations to go to Arizona State and study mechanical engineering, and his boyfriend, Sean, beautiful and geeky, also an aspiring engineer. "What about you?" he said as they drove through the pouring rain. "Do you have someone you like?" "I did," said Olivia, "but we broke up a while ago. It had been a year and a half ago, in the spring.
Priya was a year ahead of Olivia in school, and when she found out she was going to an East Coast college, she was ecstatic. Olivia hadn't wanted to keep Priya tied down. With Priya going east and Olivia staying in Arizona, it made sense to break things off. But Priya hadn't agreed, and when she'd cried and Olivia didn't, she'd accused Olivia of not caring enough to be there for her.
"But you're going out of state," Olivia had said. "I can't just move to Boston for you."
Priya had blown her wavy black hair away from her face and stared her down.
"You know that's not what I'm talking about. Even when we're together, having dinner, watching movies or whatever, you're always so detached. It feels like you're somewhere else, not with me."
Her mouth tightened.
"Is there someone else?"
There was the memory of a girl in dark cotton trousers, her hair hanging down her shoulders, pulling her from the water. There was also Mom, lying alone in the hospital, watching dramas until she fell asleep. She'd never told Priya about either, because they felt too private to talk about.
"No," said Olivia.
By the time Priya left for college, they had fallen apart. Olivia and Carlos drove the rest of the way back in silence. As they were unloading the car, Carlos stopped in his tracks. Olivia glanced at him.
"What is it?"
"I thought," he broke off, frowning. He looked pale.
"I thought I saw something over there, to your left, but it's gone now."
Olivia looked. The ghost of an old man, his body racked with disease, looked back at her. His sunken eyes glittered.
"I don't see anything," she said.
"Let's get the rest of these inside," said Carlos, hurrying past her.
Olivia cast one last look at the ghost and followed. If Carlos was starting to see them, she'd have to cook fast. The moon was rising. The ghost festival was coming. Her palms began to sweat. She wiped them on her jeans and strode inside, past the tourists beginning to mill about in the lobby with pamphlets about the ghost festival. Olivia sorted her ingredients on the counters, arranging them by dish. Duck, pork, shrimp, fish. Winter melon, out of season, but bought from one of the Chinese markets back home. Spices, marinades. Red beans, sesame oil, sugar, salt. Bok choy, green beans, lotus root, sauces that she'd spent the past 2 days making. Carlos hung back by the door.
"Don't you have work to do?" she said to him, and then winced.
Too blunt. The words are wrong. Always wrong when they came out of her.
"I do," he said. He seemed unfazed, and the tight knot in Olivia's chest loosened.
"But I want to help if I can. You need someone to help you chop and prep, right? I cook meals in this kitchen all the time."
A surge of relief flooded through her. "Thank you," she said quietly. She indicated the vegetables lying in their neat rows. "I need these chopped, garlic minced, green onions left long but not longer than a finger, carrots thinly sliced, winter melon cubed."
"Do you have a recipe?"
"Only in my head," she said. That was how Mom had done it too. Carlos sighed and picked up a knife.
"All right, let's get to work."
They worked for hours, and soon they began to learn each other's rhythm. The clock over the sink ticked, and sunlight passed across the windows and grew dark. Olivia didn't have to look outside to know that people were locking themselves in their houses, pulling the curtains shut. Only the curious tourists kept watch, peering through the large glass windows of every hotel lining the street. All of the hotels would have bolted their front doors shut except for the Grand Silver. Not the Grand Silver, because Olivia still had to hurry in and out with her food. Its thresholds were already lined with paper talismans to ward off any ghosts bent on mischief or worse. Time flew by, and Olivia sweated and braised and fried and steamed. Her muscles ached, but adrenaline and fear kept her body and mind singing. The rising spirit energy from outside grew to a tight, intense buzz in her head. She could hear the ghosts through the walls whispering, waiting, and by the expression that Carlos wore, so could he. And then there was a wet, whining sound coming from inside the hotel and the drag of broken feet in high heels in the ceiling above, somewhere in the air vents. The moon rose, and Olivia began to plait. After Olivia's mom got sick, she became too weak to move around much. She was supposed to stay still, to conserve her energy. Moving made her nauseated. But the one place that Olivia's dad couldn't chase her out of was the kitchen. Even when she had trouble standing, she still insisted on cooking dinner for the family. Olivia helped her into a chair by the stove and sat there for hours, making sure all of the meal's components were cooking properly. Olivia did what she could to ease the burden, measuring liquids, cooking the rice, making sure all the ingredients were chopped so that her mom didn't have to worry about it. One afternoon, her mother smiled up at her. "You're getting so good at this. I'm glad. You'll have to do this when I'm gone." A lump rose in Olivia's throat. "That's not going to happen." "I can't fill your shoes," she thought. "You're going to get better." "Don't let the sesame seeds burn," said Mom, and Olivia swooped in automatically, rescuing the frying pan full of toasted seeds. "Good, good. Let them cool somewhere safe." Olivia set them aside in a small bowl. Her hands were trembling. "I can't lose you. Dad can't lose you. You're going to get better. I know it." Mom reached out. Her fingers felt so delicate, so thin. "If you honor everything I've taught you, then I promise that I will never leave you." She held Olivia's hand and squeezed it. "I love you, Shi'i." Olivia hadn't heard that name in years, not since her grandma had passed away. Tears welled up in her eyes. "Mom." The kitchen timer went off. Her mom moved to take the gingdo paikwat off the heat and transferred it into a waiting ceramic dish. "Remember," she said to Olivia. "Now take this to the table." The banquet table waited on the Grand Silver's porch, safe from the rainstorm and the rushing water below. An outline of talismans marked a boundary around it leading to the hotel doors. All along its edges, ghosts clustered and crowded, whispering among themselves. They were substantial, all flesh and bone, just for this one night, just a feast until the sun came up. Above, in a gap in the heavy clouds, the full moon hovered like a malevolent eye. Olivia came out with a cart laden with giant pots and stacked with metal dishes, clattering past the tourists gathered in the lobby, ignoring their questions. She refused to let Carlos follow her out onto the porch, and she felt his eyes on her back as she crossed the Grand Silver's threshold. She laid platter after platter of Peking duck in the center of the table, forming a line of meat and soft, pale, steamed buns. She removed the lids of the pots, and the scent of wintermelon soup rose through the thick air. As quickly as she could, she began to fill bowls. The ghosts whispered and pushed their hands up against the barrier, hissing when copper-scented magic sparked against their skin. Cold sweat rose on Olivia's back, but her hands were steady as she continued to ladle soup into bowls. Finally, there was no more room on the tabletop. Olivia stepped back, laying down another line of talismans so that there was a narrow, unobstructed passage from the door to the table. She raised her voice. "Welcome, honored guests. My name is Olivia Chang, and I have prepared you a banquet so that you may take and eat and find peace in your souls." Her mom had given this speech many times, and Olivia did not stumble. "Please come. You are welcome at this table." With that, she broke the talisman barrier around the table. The ghosts fell upon the food. They shoved at each other, grabbing bowls, seizing chopsticks. Some used their hands and pushed food into their mouths as fast as they could. Many of them barely looked human in their hunger. They tore into the meat with ferocity, pushed their faces into the bowls of soup, and snarled at their neighbors to get at the dishes they wanted. The food seemed to evaporate as the ghosts fought and bit and ate
8, 8. I didn't make enough, Olivia thought wildly. Dread built in her stomach. All of these people came to my table, and I can't serve them all.
Breathe, she breathed. Grabbing the cart, she doubled back for more food.
Shrimp in clear, sweet sauce. Crab with ginger and scallions, fish after fish, all steamed with sharp, salty sauce. Tender marinated beef, still sizzling on metal plates. Bak chikai with all of the sauces, hot pepper pork chops. Her mother's gingdo paikwat, sweet and glazed in bright red sauce, sprinkled with toasted sesame seeds. Olivia's heart ached. And then, lastly, platter after platter of sliced oranges and bowls of sweet red bean soup. It vanished almost as soon as she put it out, but Olivia kept up her pace, her legs burning, her hands steady. The night wore on, and more spirits flocked to the table, replacing those who had filled their bellies and wandered away. The moon drifted. In the lulls between waves, Olivia kept watch, burning incense and joss paper over a small fire. Embers wafted up into the air like wishes, and one by one, they winked out. The rain poured down relentlessly. Mei Ling did not appear. Olivia watched the table, chewing on her lip so hard that it began to taste raw. Ghosts came, some eating quietly, some ravenous. The wildness in their eyes, their grief, their fear and rage, all ebbed as they ate. "Take and eat," she'd said. The Chinese-American ghosts were the ones who wept the most, laughing and reveling in familiar foods. "Thank you," they told her, one after another. "I never thought I would taste this again." And one after another, they vanished, fading away to rest at last. This was why she was here, as Exorcist Chang. It was only an exorcism in the loosest sense. Her work wasn't an act of expulsion. Her role was to soothe lonely souls, offering them freedom. Olivia thought about the footsteps overhead, the sobbing at night. She sent up her piece of joss paper and headed back inside through the clump of tourists in the lobby. They tried to speak to her, but she didn't hear them. She stopped by the reception desk, staring up at the portrait of the Wailing Lady. Yesterday, Renee had leaned over the counter and smiled at her. "Our Wailing Lady is getting unruly. Could you look into fixing that up or finding a replacement?" The longer a ghost stayed in one place without release, the more restless it became. Bisden lived and died on its haunted attraction tourism, and when a ghost acted up, it lent legitimacy to the stories. But ghosts that were trapped for too long began to go mad, and that was when people got hurt. Olivia stared at the painting, at the white veil covering the Wailing Lady's face. In the 10 years of ghost festivals since the first one at the Grand Silver, Olivia hadn't seen Mei Ling once. Beneath that veil, she could be anyone. She turned and ran for the kitchen. There was still some rice, just enough for a bowl. Everything else was gone, presented on the table outside. Olivia hoped the rice would do. She took the stairs up to the third floor and headed back to her room. As she ascended, the familiar sound of sobbing drifted down towards her, and she climbed faster. When Olivia opened the door, she saw a woman standing inside by the window, gazing out at the feast below. She wore a white wedding gown, stained with dirt at the hem, and a long white veil. She turned to face Olivia. Olivia peeled the talisman necklace from her neck and laid it on the floor beside her. Slowly, she approached, holding out the rice. "I brought you something to eat," she said. This time, her voice didn't sound too loud in her ears. "It's not much, but you seem hungry. Please, honored guest, take and eat." The Wailing Woman didn't move, but she let Olivia approach. Steam wafted gently from the rice into the air. Rain battered down outside, beating at the window, demanding to be let in. Olivia reached out, offering up the bowl. The ghost reached back, taking it. The hands around hers were warm and solid. Gently, Olivia pushed back the veil. When Olivia's mom died, she didn't come back as a ghost. Olivia half expected her to, but she didn't materialize in the hospital room when Dad chose to take her off life support, or on any of the nights when Olivia heard her dad crying alone in his bedroom. At the funeral, there had only been the silent mom-shaped body nestled in her casket. People became ghosts when they were restless or had unfinished business or held too much regret to pass on. They became ghosts when the ones they loved forgot them or didn't pay them respects. Olivia burned incense despite the fire warnings on especially dry days, and some days she set aside a small dish of whatever she was cooking to put on Mom's altar later. But she kept the small shrine in her room, away from Dad. Whenever he saw it, his mouth would crumple and he'd leave abruptly, his grief chasing him somewhere else. Olivia started staying late at school, just to be somewhere else. She withdrew from her friends, hiding in the library. Her grades suffered and improved. Slowly, it dawned on her that her mom was gone. Not just dead and a ghost gone, but gone, gone. People only became ghosts when they had something tying them to this place. Olivia's mom, it seemed, had nothing to keep her here. Olivia didn't apply to college. Every time she reached the family section on the application, parents' names, level of education, relationship, living, deceased, her head filled with static. The essay questions were inane. What did you do last summer and how did it impact you? Just made her think of the ugly, ultra-clean stink of the hospital and how she would never forget it. As much as she wanted to. Besides, someone had to take care of Dad. She couldn't leave him too. Her relationship with Priya crumbled, and Olivia let it. Her friends packed and left for college, and Olivia cooked and paid bills and cooked. She made sure all of her mom's emails were forwarded to her own email address, and that the small dish in front of her altar was never empty. When she opened the email from the Grand Silver asking Exorcist Chang to prepare her banquet for the Ghost Festival that year, Olivia's heartbeat jumped. The one night when spirits walk among us. She'd helped prepare the banquet every year, but she'd never done it alone. And she hadn't been back to the Grand Silver since that first summer in Bisden. Dad, she said that evening, twisting her napkin into tight rings under the table. I'm going to Bisden in August. He looked up with a sad smile. He'd gotten so much older in the past months, she realized. I know, he said. Olivia found herself looking into the face of a stranger, a hard face, weathered with age and hunger. It wasn't Mei Ling. It wasn't Mom. It wasn't anyone she knew. Who are you? Olivia whispered, and the ghost stared silently back at her. The old woman's gaze was vacant, and she shifted back and forth, her ill-fitting wedding dress whispering around her. Olivia wondered if she was a bride at all, or if someone had bound her to the Grand Silver Hotel against her will to serve as their ghost. This woman didn't look like the young, pretty white girl that the hotel's brochures advertised as the Wailing Lady. Maybe that hadn't mattered to the person who had trapped her here. But if there was a night for truth, it was tonight. Mom had said so. During the festival, ghosts were most themselves, not what the living wanted, not what Olivia wanted. The night of the festival was a chance for freedom. Olivia bit back her disappointment and smiled at the woman. She held out a pair of chopsticks, and the woman took them and began to eat. The rice wasn't much, something small and humble. But with every bite, the woman's gaze grew sharper and more aware, and her movements became more coordinated. Soon the rice was gone. Olivia opened her mouth to apologize, but the stranger spoke first.
"Thank you," she said.
Her voice was raspy, and Olivia wondered if it was because of all her crying.
"Will you walk me to the door, child?"
Olivia took her arm and led her to the elevator. The woman gazed at her reflection in the elevator's brass walls as they rode down to the first floor. They walked together past the tourists, who gawked but kept a healthy distance. Olivia thought she saw Renee moving toward them, but the crowd of tourists had closed in tight against each other, blocking her way with their bodies. As they crossed the threshold, the woman raised her arms, and her white wedding dress and veil crumbled into dust. Somewhere behind them, Renee shouted. Beneath the dress, the woman wore hardy cotton traveling clothes and a loose coat. There was a hat in her hands that she placed on her head, tugging the brim. She looked about as old as Olivia's grandma had been when she died, and like Olivia's grandma, she was Chinese. Definitely not the tragic young white bride that the wailing lady was purported to be.
"Thank you for the food, child," said the woman.
She patted Olivia's arm.
"After being alone for so long, I forgot what it felt like to have family cook for you, and that is what your offering felt like."
She began to fade, but before she was fully gone, she gave Olivia's arm a squeeze.
"Go feed your guests."
Olivia looked up. The sky was beginning to lighten, and most of the ghosts had vanished. But there were still a few at the table, picking at the remains of the food. One of them stood out, a girl wearing trousers with deep brown hair and a small mouth. Her clothing and hair were soaked, and when she caught sight of Olivia, the corners of her mouth curved upwards. "The Game Boy girl," said Mei Ling. "You grew up." Warm welcome heat spread through Olivia's chest. Mei Ling hadn't changed at all since she'd first seen her. "I did," she said, "thanks to you." Mei Ling looked at the table and sighed. "It's almost all gone. It looks so good, too." She tucked a strand of hair behind her ear, scanning the remnants of the banquet. "I almost made it to the table the last time your mom cooked at the Grand Silver, but I didn't get there in time." Olivia's stomach dropped. She remembered Mei Ling carrying her, bearing her towards the Grand Silver. Had she slowed her down and caused her to miss her chance to cross over? "I know what you're thinking," said Mei Ling. She reached out to ruffle Olivia's hair. When she pulled away, her crooked fingers brushed against Olivia's forehead. "Don't. I don't regret it. I saw a little kid in trouble, and I did my best to save her. I wish someone had been there to do that for me." The most important part of service was being considerate of others, Mom had said. Olivia bit her lip and scanned the table. All the plates had been picked over, even the fish skins and eyes were gone. "I'm going to find you something to eat," she said. "I'm going to feed you so you can find your way home." Mei Ling shook her head. "The sun's rising, kid. The banquet's over." Olivia picked through the plates with her fingers, pushing aside gnawed-on bones. There was no gristle, and most of the sauce had been licked off of the plates. Mei Ling was right. There was no food left on the table. Her gaze flicked to the serving cart resting by the Grand Silver's door. She crouched beside it, peering between the shelves. There, she thought. Splashes of sauce and little bits of food had spilled out of their dishes and onto the metal as she'd pushed the cart through the hotel. Taking her wooden paddle, Olivia carefully scraped them into her palm. Her heart ached. "Welcome, honored guest," she said, holding her hand out to Mei Ling. "Take and eat, and let your soul be uplifted." Mei Ling opened her mouth, closed it. Startled tears welled up in her eyes. She reached for Olivia's hand, cradling it in her left hand and scooping up the food with her right. As she ate, her mangled fingers straightened and became whole, and her bones twisted themselves back into shape with a series of ugly cracking sounds. Her wounds closed one by one. "Stay with me," Olivia wanted to say. "Don't eat my food. Don't go." She swallowed her words and held her hand still. By the time Mei Ling swallowed the last grain of rice, her face was streaked with tears. She wiped them away. "Thank you," she said. Her voice was hoarse but clear. Olivia took her hand, lacing their fingers. It was warm, so warm. Behind her, the clouds were thinning into fine strands with the returning heat. The moon had waned and the rain dropped off. With a sigh, the last ghost at her table evaporated into the morning air.
The Secret Lives of the Nine Negro Teeth of George Washington by P. Gelley Clark. A quote by Lund Washington, Mount Vernon Plantation account book, dated 1784. By cash paid Negroes for nine teeth on account of Dr. LeMoyer. The first Negro tooth purchased for George Washington came from a blacksmith who died that very year at Mount Vernon of the flux. The art of the blacksmith had been in his blood, passed down from ancestral spirits who had come seeking their descendants across the sea. Back in what the elder slaves called Africa, he had heard, blacksmiths were revered men who drew iron from the earth and worked it with fire and magic, crafting spears so wondrous they could pierce the sky and swords with beauty enough to rend mountains. Here, in this colony of Virginia, he had been set to shape crueler things. Collars to fasten about bowed necks, shackles to ensnare tired limbs, and muzzles to silence men like beasts. But blacksmiths know the secret language of iron, and he beseeched his creations to bind the spirits of their wielders as surely as they bound flesh. For the blacksmith understood what masters had chosen to forget. When you make a man or woman a slave, you enslave yourself in turn, and the souls of those who made thralls of others would never know rest in this life or the next. When he wore that tooth, George Washington complained of hearing the heavy fall of a hammer on an anvil day and night. He ordered all iron making stopped at Mount Vernon, but the sound of the blacksmith's hammer rang out in his head all the same. The second Negro tooth belonging to George Washington came from a slave from the kingdom of Ebony, what the English, with their inarticulate tongues, call Bonnyland, and much to his annoyance, hence him, a bonny man. The bonny man journeyed from Africa on a ship called the Jesus, which, as he understood, was named for an ancient sorcerer who defied death. Unlike the other slaves bound on that ship who came from the hinterlands beyond his kingdom, he knew the fate that awaited him, though he would never know what law or sacred edict he had broken that sent him to this fate. He found himself in that fetid hole, chained beside a merman, with scales that sparkled like green jewels and eyes as round as black coins. The bonny man had seen mermen before, out among the waves, and stories said some of them swam into rivers to find wives among local fisherwomen. But he hadn't known the whites made slaves of them too. As he would later learn, mermen were prized by thaumaturgical inclined aristocrats, who dressed them in fine livery to display to guests. Most, however, were destined for Spanish holdings, where they were forced to dive for giant pearls off the shores of New Granada. The two survived the horrors of the passage by relying on each other. The bonny man shared tales of his kingdom, of his wife and children and family, forever lost. The merman, in turn, told of his underwater home, of its queen and many curiosities. He also taught the body man a song, a plea to old and terrible things that dwelled in the deep, dark, hidden parts of the sea. Great beings with gaping mouths that opened up whirlpools or tentacles that could drag ships beneath the depths. They would one day rise to wreak vengeance, he promised, for all those who had been chained to suffer in these floating coffins. The Bonnie Man never saw the mermen after they made land on the English Isle of Barbados, but he carried the song with him as far as the colony of Virginia, and on the Mount Vernon plantation he sang it as he looked across fields of wheat to an ocean he couldn't see, and waited. When George Washington wore the Bonnie Man's tooth, he found himself humming an unknown song that sounded, strange to his thinking, like the tongue of the savage merman. And in the dark, hidden parts of the sea, old and terrible things stirred. The third Negro tooth of George Washington was bought from a slave who later ran from Mount Vernon, of which an account was posted in the Virginia Gazette in 1785. Advertisement: runaway from the plantation of the subscriber in Fairfax County. Sometime in October last, on All Hallows Eve, a mulatto fellow, 5 feet 8 inches high, of tawny complexion, named Tom, about 25 years of age, missing a front tooth. He is sensible for a slave and self-taught in foul necromancy. He lived for some years previous as a servant at a school of learned sorcery near Williamsburg, and was removed on account of inciting the dead slaves there to rise up in insurrection. It is supposed he returned to the school to raise up a young Negro wench named Anne, a former servant who died of the pox and was buried on the campus grounds, his sister. He sold away a tooth, and with that small money was able to purchase a spell used to call upon powers potent on All Hallows' Eve to spirit themselves away to parts now unknown. Whoever will secure the said Tom living and Anne dead, so that they be delivered to the plantation of the subscriber in Fairfax County aforesaid, shall have 20 shillings reward, besides what the law allows. To George Washington's frustration, Tom's tooth frequently fell out of his dentures, no matter how he tried to secure it. Most bizarre of all, he would find it often in the unlikeliest of places, as if the vexing thing was deliberately concealing itself. Then one day the tooth was gone altogether, never to be seen again. George Washington's fourth Negro tooth was from a woman named Henrietta. Contrary to widespread belief, there is no difference of significance between the dentition of men and women, as any trained dentist, odontomancer, or the fae folk who require human teeth as currency will attest. Henrietta's father had been John Indian, whose father had been a Yamasee warrior captured and sold into bondage in Virginia. Her mother's mother had come to the mainland from Jamaica, sold away for taking part in Queen Nanny's war. As slaves, both were reputed to be unruly and impossible to control. Henrietta inherited that defiant blood, and more than one owner learned the hard way she wasn't to be trifled with. After holding down and whipping her last mistress soundly, she was sold to work fields at Mount Vernon, because as her former master advertised, strong legs and a broad back weren't to be wasted. Henrietta often dreamed of her grandparents. She often dreamed she was her grandparents. Sometimes she was a Yamasee warrior, charging a fort with flintlock musket drawn, eyes fixed on the soldier she intended to kill, as from the ramparts, English mages hurled volleys of emerald fireballs that could melt through iron. Other times she was a young woman, barely 15, who chanted Asante war songs as she drove a long saber, the blade blazing bright with obeah, into the belly of a slave master. This one had been a pallid blood drinker, and watched as he blackened and crumbled away to ash. When George Washington wore Henrietta's tooth, He sometimes woke screaming from night terrors. He told Martha they were memories from the war and would never speak of the faces he saw coming for him in those dreams. A fierce Indian man with long black hair and death in his eyes, and a laughing slave girl with a curiously innocent face who plunged scorching steel into his belly. The fifth Negro tooth belonging to George Washington came by unexplained means from a conjureman who was not listed among Mount Vernon's slaves. He had been born before independence in what was then the province of New Jersey and learned his trade from his mother, a root woman of some renown among local slaves at any rate, having been brought to the region from the southern territories of New France. The conjureman used his magics mostly in the treatment of maladies affecting his fellow bondsmen, of the mundane or paranormal varieties. He had been one of the tens of thousands of slaves during the war who answered the call put out by the Earl of Dunmore, Royal Governor of Virginia, in November 1775. "And I hereby declare all indentured servants, Negroes, hedge witches and wizards, occultists, lycanthropes, giants, non-cannibal ogres, and any sentient magical creatures or others, appertaining to rebels, free and relieved of supernatural sanction, that are able and willing to bear arms, they joining His Majesty's troops as soon as may be, for the more speedily reducing this colony to a proper sense of their duty, to His Majesty's crown and dignity. This edict excludes demonic beasts, who should not take said proclamation as a summons, who in doing so will be exorcised from His Majesty's realm with all deliberate speed." The conjureman was first put in the service of Hessian mercenaries to care for their frightening midnight black steeds that breathed flames with hooves of fire. Following, he'd been set to performing menial domestic spells for Scottish warlocks, treated no better there than a servant. It was fortune, aided by some skillful stone casting, that placed him in Colonel Ty's regiment. Like the conjureman, Ty had been a slave in New Jersey, who fled to the British, working his way to becoming a respected guerrilla commander. Ty led the infamous Black Brigade, a motley crew of fugitive slaves, outlaw jujumen, and even a Spanish mulatto werewolf, who worked alongside the elite Queens Rangers. Aided by the conjureman's Gree-Gree, the Black Brigade carried out raids on militiamen, launching attacks on their homes, destroying their weapons, stealing supplies, burning spells and striking fear into the hearts of patriots. The conjureman's brightest moment had come the day he captured his own master and bound him in the same shackles he'd once been forced to wear. The brigade stirred such hysteria that the patriot governor of New Jersey declared martial law, putting up protective wards around the province, and General George Washington himself was forced to send his best mage hunters against them. In a running skirmish with those patriot huntsmen, Ty was fatally struck by a cursed ball from a long rifle, cutting through his gree-gree. The conjureman stood guard over his fallen commander, performing a final rite that would disallow their enemies from reanimating the man or binding his soul. Of the five mage hunters, he killed three, but was felled in the attempt. With his final breath, he whispered his own curse on any that would desecrate his corpse. One of the surviving mage hunters pulled the conjureman's teeth as a souvenir of the battle, and a few days hence tumbled to land awkwardly from his horse and broke his neck. The tooth passed to a second man, who choked to death on an improbably lodged bit of turtle soup in his windpipe. And so it went, bringing dire misfortune to each of its owners. The conjureman's tooth has now, by some twist of fate, made its way to Mount Vernon and into George Washington's collection. He has not worn it yet. The sixth Negro tooth of George Washington belonged to a slave who had tumbled here from another world. The startled English sorcerer, who witnessed this remarkable event, had been set to deliver a speech on conjurations at the Royal Society of London for improving supernatural knowledge. Alas, before the sorcerer could tell the world of his discovery, he was quietly killed by agents of the Second Royal African Company, working in a rare alliance with their Dutch rivals. As they saw it, if Negroes could simply be pulled out of thin air, the lucrative trade in human cargo that made such mercantilists wealthy could be irrevocably harmed. The conjured Negro, however, was allowed to live, bundled up and shipped from London to a Virginia slave market. Good property, after all, was not to be wasted. She ended up in Mount Vernon and was given the name Esther. The other slaves, however, called her Solomon on account of her wisdom. Solomon claimed not to know anything about magic, which didn't exist in her native home. But how could that be, the other slaves wondered, when she could mix together powders to cure their sicknesses better than any physician? When she could make predictions of the weather that always came true? When she could construct all manner of wondrous contraptions from the simplest of objects? Even the plantation manager claimed she was a Negro of curious intellect and listened to her suggestions on crop rotations and field systems. The slaves well knew the many agricultural reforms at Mount Vernon for which their master took credit was actually Solomon's genius. They often asked why she didn't use her remarkable wit to get hired out and make money. Certainly, that'd be enough to buy her freedom. Solomon always shook her head, saying that though she was from another land, she felt tied to them by the consanguinity of bondage. She would work to free them all, or falling short of that, at the least bring some measure of ease to their lives. But at night, after she'd finished her mysterious experiments, which she kept secret from all, she could be found gazing up at the stars, and it was hard not to see the longing held deep in her eyes. When George Washington wore Solomon's tooth, he dreamed of a place of golden spires and colorful glass domes, where Negroes flew through the sky on metal wings like birds, and sprawling cities that glowed bright at night were run by machines who thought faster than men. It both awed and frightened him at once. The seventh Negro tooth purchased for George Washington had come from a Negro from Africa, who himself had once been a trader in slaves. He had not gone out with the raids or the wars between kingdoms to procure them, but had been an instrumental middleman, a translator who spoke the languages of both the coastal slavers and their European buyers. He was instrumental in keeping the enchanted rifles and rum jugs flowing and assuring his benefactors a good value for the human merchandise. It was thus ironic that his downfall came from making a bad deal. The local ruler, a distant relative to a king, felt cheated, and much to the trader's shock, announced his translator put up for sale. The English merchant gladly accepted the offer, and just like that, the trader went from a man of position to a commodity. He went half mad of despair when they chained him in the hold of the slave ship. Twice he tried to rip out his throat with his fingernails, preferring death to captivity. But each time he died, he returned to life without sign of injury. He jumped into the sea to drown, only to be hauled back in without a drop of water in his lungs. He'd managed to get hold of a sailor's knife, driven it into his chest, and watched in shock as his body pushed the blade out and healed the wound. It was then he understood the extent of his downfall. He had been cursed, perhaps by the gods, perhaps by spirits of the vengeful dead, or by some witch or conjurer for whom he'd haggled out a good price. He would never know. But they had cursed him to suffer this turn of fate, to become what he'd made of others. And there would be no escape. The Negro slave trader's tooth was George Washington's favorite. No matter how much he used it, the tooth showed no signs of wear. Sometimes he could have sworn he'd broken it. But when inspected, it didn't show as much as a fracture, as if it mended itself. He put that tooth to work hardest of all, and gave it not a bit of rest. The eighth Negro tooth belonging to George Washington came from his cook, who was called Ulysses. He had become a favorite in the Mount Vernon household, known for his culinary arts and the meticulous care he gave to his kitchen. The dinners and parties held at the mansion were always catered by Ulysses, and visitors praised his skill at devising new dishes to tingle the tongue and salivate the senses. Those within the higher social circles, frequented by the Washingtons, familiarly called him Uncle Lissies, and showered him with such gifts that local papers remarked, "The Negro cook had become something of a celebrated puffed-up dandy." Ulysses took his work seriously, as much as he took his name. He used the monies gained from those gifts, as well as his habit of selling leftovers. People paid good money to sup on the Washington's fair, to purchase translated works by Homer. In those pages, he learned about the fascinating travels of his namesake, and was particularly taken by the figure Circe, an enchantress famed for her vast knowledge of potions and herbs, who through a fine feast, laced with a potent elixir, had turned men into swine. Ulysses amassed other books as well, Eastern texts on Chinese herbology, banned manuscripts of Muslim alchemy, even rare ancient Egyptian papyri on shape-shifting. His first tests at transmogrification had merely increased the appetite of Washington's guests, who turned so ravenous they relieved themselves of knife or spoon and shoveled fistfuls of food into their mouths like beasts. A second test had set them all to loud, high-pitched squealing, which was blamed on an over-imbibing of cherubimical spirits. Success came at last when he heard some days after a summer dining party that a Virginia plantation owner and close friend of the Washingtons had gone missing. The very same day, his wife had found a great fat spotted hog rummaging noisily through their parlor. She had her slaves round up the horrid beast, which was summarily butchered and served for dinner. Over the years, Ulysses was judicious in his selections for the transfiguring brew. Several slave owners or overseers known to be particularly cruel, a shipping merchant from Rhode Island whose substantial wealth came from the slave trade, a visiting French physiognomist and naturalist who prattled on about the inherent lower mental capabilities to be found among Negroes, whose skulls he compared to near-human creatures, such as the apes of inner Africa and the fierce woodland goblins of Bavaria. Then, one day in early 1797, Ulysses disappeared. The Washingtons were upset and hunted everywhere for their absconded cook, putting out to all who would listen the kindness they'd shown to the ungrateful servant. He was never found, but the Mount Vernon slaves whispered that on the day Ulysses vanished, a black crow with a mischievous glint in its eye was found standing in a pile of the man's abandoned clothes. It cawed once and then flapped away. When George Washington wore the tooth of his runaway cook, it was strangely at dinner parties. Slaves would watch as he wandered into the kitchen, eyes glazed over in a seeming trance, and placed drops of some strange liquid into the food and drinks of his guests. His servants never touched those leftovers. But that summer, many Virginians took note of a bizarre rash of wild pigs infesting the streets and countryside of Fairfax County. The ninth and final Negro tooth purchased for George Washington came from a slave woman named Emma. She had been among Mount Vernon's earliest slaves, born there just a decade after Augustine Washington had moved in with his family. Had anyone recorded Emma's life for posterity, they would have learned of a girl who came of age in the shadows of one of Virginia's most powerful families. A girl who had fast learned that she was included among the Washington's possessions, treasured like a chair cut from exotic Jamaican mahogany, or a bit of fine Canton porcelain. A young woman who had watched the Washington children go on to attend school and learn the ways of the gentry while she was trained to wait on their whims. They had the entire world to explore and discover. Her world was Mount Vernon, and her aspirations could grow no further than the wants and needs of her owners. That was not to say Emma did not have her own life, for slaves learned early how to carve out spaces separate from their masters. She had befriended, loved, married, cried, fought, and found succor in a community as vibrant as the Washingtons, perhaps even more so, if only because they understood how precious it was to live. Yet she still dreamed for more, to be unbound from this place, to live a life where she had not seen friends and family put under the lash, a life where the children she bore were not the property of others, a place where she might draw a free breath and taste its sweetness. Emma didn't know any particular sorcery. She was no root woman or conjurer, nor had she been trained like the Washington women in simple domestic enchantments. But her dreams worked their own magic, a strong and potent magic that she clung to, that grew up and blossomed inside her, where not even her owners could touch or take it away. When George Washington wore Emma's tooth, some of that magic worked its way into him and perhaps troubled some small bit of his soul. In July 1799, 6 months before he died, Washington stipulated in his will that the 123 slaves belonging to himself, among them Emma, be freed upon his wife's death. No such stipulations were made, for the Negro teeth still in his possession. Yard Dog by Tade Thompson. I thought he was a Fed at first. Okay. No, I didn't. But in hindsight, I should have. The second time he turned up at Saucy Sue's, everybody noticed him on account of his height and his clothes, which were righteous. I'm the only one who saw him arrive the night before. He was furtive, dressed in, I don't know what, man. He wore shoes and pants that even the Salvation Army would turn down. The height was there, but he was such a dark cat that without the flash of jewelry, he faded into the background. I played percussion that first night. Al played the horn, some shit he'd cribbed off watching Dizzy in St. Louis. Saucy Sue's was a gangster's joint, but many of the jazz clubs were back then, and a Fed or two or an undercover cop wasn't out of the ordinary. He was a yard dog that first night, and every other night he came in, that's the name that stuck in my head, even before he started playing. Al and I were filling in. The usual percussion and horn guys were dope sick trying to kick a habit, and the manager, a cat called Layton, literally plucked us out of the crowd. That was the beginning of a 6-month gig, sweet, and I cut my teeth for later in my career. Nothing like playing 6 nights a week to hone your discipline. Yard Dog was at the back, watching, smoking some hand-rolled stuff that I thought had some reefer mixed in. But when the cop stopped us one time and checked, it was only tobacco. But it wasn't that simple. Motherfucker switched that shit, I'm sure, because I remember he blew the smoke in my face when I was talking shit one time. I saw things, but considering what happened later, a few hallucinations were nothing to make noise about. Yard Dog was like 6'6" if he was an inch. Broad shoulders, narrow hips, athletic looking, but stooped, bringing himself down to earth, Al would say. First night, he didn't say nothing. Just watched, smoked, and left. Second night, he was waiting when we packed up for the night, and he said, "That was real cool." He walked away before I could respond. We had a singer then, called herself Shonda. voice would break an angel's heart. She took her sweet time watching him walk away. Difficult not to, I suppose. Yard dog was visible, noticeable even before he opened his mouth. Why, then, had nobody seen him on that first night? I think that was down to him, down to how much he wanted to be seen. Sue's had audience nights every 2 weeks or so, usually when the band was fatigued or someone was sick or talking to their P.O. Those nights, Al and me would kick back with some drinks and listen to some hopped-up or drunk motherfuckers trying to hold a tune. Though we always refused, one or two of them always asked to try our instruments, and Al had to smack a persistent cat once. Al wasn't big like Yard Dog, but he was fierce, fast, and experienced. He'd been in plenty of fights and loved to talk about either music or beating a person down. I remember a cat they used to call Captain before our time just got out of prison. Captain stole Al's reefer and sat on the stoop of the Patterson Hotel smoking all hotsy-totsy. Al takes a mouthful of coffin varnish, walks up to Captain, spits the liquor in his face, kicks him in the bongos, lights him on fire, and only trillies because of a pounder who ran up. But fuck Captain. He was unhep. On this night, some drunk guy was playing Armstrongs, but sadder than a map, depressing everyone. Sue's doesn't waste time with inferior entertainment. You could be high until you're touching God's toenails. Nobody would care as long as you played well. But if you blew shit, your survival time was the 5 minutes it takes Benny to get from the door, through the crowd, to the stage. Open night is no excuse for bad jazz. So shitty drunk guy was out, and Yard was next. He went up there and put his lips to it. I can't tell you what he played, because I don't remember. But I do know that the note was clear and high and piercing. Not a soul spoke. Not a soul could speak, because whatever Yard played made everybody blow their wigs, man. Bible. I was unaware of any other person in that room. Yard himself disappeared, and everything was that note, that sound, that fucking horn. I don't know how long it lasted, but when he stopped, he was staring down at the floor. There was silence, and I know I was crying. Shit, everyone in Saucy Sue's was crying. Pimps, prostitutes, hustlers, every single one. It seemed it was silent for hours, but it couldn't have been more than a minute or two. Then people started clapping and whooping. Yard calmly picked up his instrument and walked off the stage. No other blower would go up there, because how do you follow that? Understand, I'm not talking about skill here. Yard could beat it out, but what I'm talking about here is magic. One other thing, something curious. All the drinks in the house went bitter that night. When people got their emotions together, they found themselves thirsty, and they drank and spat everything out. There was nothing worth drinking or listening to. The drug fiends even said there was no dragon to chase. All intoxicants would not intoxicate. It was the damnedest thing. I tell you, that night, any woman or man would have dropped their drawers for him. But Yard left. Next night he's back, leaning against the wall, cool as ever. Better dressed, but his name stuck. He carried his horn everywhere. Gossip blossomed like hopheads in a flophouse. Where did he live? Where was he from? He wasn't some tender motherfucker on leave from Juilliard. Choir boy from church, maybe. Many jazz guys got their chops blowing Amazing Grace. What kind of horn was that anyway? One of those English Bessons? A Higham? The fire of speculation burned and would continue to burn until the next open night. Shonda took a fancy to him and preened to get his attention. It worked. You should know that Owl and Shonda used to be a thing, and now they're, well, I don't know. I can't say not a thing, but they still have business. Shonda did go on a date with Yard, but that was after Shed came along. Shed wasn't his name. We called him that for reasons you'll understand in a minute. Never did catch what he called himself, and by the time we met him later, there was no need to call him anything but scary. Shed turns up during this god-awful argument between Saucy's and the supplier about that booze that went bad. This was unnecessary because, for one thing, the booze was fine until Yard blew. Secondly, it wasn't just the liquor that went off. The water, the milk, the orange juice, anything you can chuck down your neck had been bitterfied. Unlike Yard, Shed was small. Not ugly, but plain. You never saw a person more uncomfortable in human skin. Shed moved like the devil himself was walking behind him, prodding him with a pitchfork. Spurts of speed, then uncertain shuffling, then fast again, always looking surprised when he made a few steps. Speaking of skin, he was one of those brothers minted so dark, he seemed navy blue. He, at first, couldn't be heard over the shouts. Then, when noticed, his language seemed so garbled that they thought him a foreigner, which I suppose he was. Nobody saw him come in. "Negro, what do you want?" Sue said. "Speak slowly and in English, fool." You need to know that Sue herself was a formidable woman, not to be fucked with. Not just that she was big, nearly 6 feet tall, and with the attitude of a drill sergeant. She had backing, if you know what I mean. There were shadowy people who owned the bar lined up behind her, folks who don't declare to the IRS, and who pounders and snatchers ignore because it's impossible to convict. This was not unusual, and you need to remember the times for what they were. This was when luminaries like Cab Calloway and Dizzy Gillespie got into a knife fight back in 1941. What I'm saying is, nobody was to be fucked with back then. Not even refined motherfuckers like Earl Hines. You didn't start nothing. You didn't mess with anybody. Nobody worth listening to anyway. Shed just smiled into her face and spoke slowly. In English. "Please, have you seen my brother? Thank you." "What?" Shed said it slower and louder. "Please, have you seen my brother? Thank you." "I don't know you or your brother. How did you get in anyway? We're not open. Get the fuck out of here." The way I heard it, Shed just smiled at her and went to use the john, but never came back out. Hours later, when tempers had cooled somewhat, Sue got curious about him, had one of the men check the bathroom. They found his raggedy clothes, a trail of blood, strips of skin, meat and other fluids leading from the door to one of the stalls. Al said it was like he had shed his skin, which is how come we call him Shed. It wasn't till later that we figured he was looking for Yard. Over the next few days, we didn't see Shed, but knew he was all over the place because people kept talking about this guy asking questions and finding crumpled clothes in any combination of skin and flesh, no bones. It was the weirdest thing, but it was a stunt of some kind, right? Like in 53 when those dumbasses shaved and dyed a rhesus monkey green, then blowtorched the asphalt, calling it an alien landing. Yard was hanging out with us a lot, at rehearsals, whenever we were kicking back, or sometimes at Dizzy's house on 7th Avenue in Harlem. He met Miles and Monk. Charlie Parker was usually too high to remember meeting him. One night, Shonda finally convinces Yard to go yam with him at some fancy place. She was really insistent, and they left us. I noticed Al watching, and I first thought he was jealous. I was worried he was going to attack Yard, but that's not what happened. He said we had to go too. I'm not too proud of this part, but Al and I used to run together. We weren't making much money as musicians, and we did take drugs. Pretty much everybody in the scene did back then. Al did some burglaries, and I went along sometimes. Not trying to say he had to twist my arm, you understand. I wasn't willing, but not exactly unwilling either. Al took us to Yard's place that night. Don't ask me how he found out where the guy lived, but he must have followed him. He said he was working with Shonda, and we'd have to split the take. No lock can resist Al. And when we got in, he went about the business of finding valuables. I saw the horn case. I'd like to say there was some magnetic pull, or that the thing called to me, or something that would absolve me. Fact is, I was just curious. The case was unremarkable and opened easily. The horn itself gleamed. I could not tell who made it, and there was no brand, serial number, or trademark anywhere. That was itself strange. Brass wasn't cheap, and all the good ones had serial numbers. Next thing I know, it's in my hands, and then, well, it's on my lips. I blew. Later, Shonda told me at that very moment Yard looked up, alarmed, and stood to leave the restaurant without so much as a see you later. Al said he dropped the cash he had scavenged and clasped his hands to his ears to shut the sound out. I didn't know any of this at the time, because I heard nothing. Even thought it was broken. It wasn't. What happened is, the room started to glow. Orange. Like a coal fire at first. Then a hurricane of color swirling around me, but detached from the origins. Blues, maroons, greens, swirling like ghosts. The walls, though still there, became immaterial or invisible. Everything clear as one of those engineering drawings, leached of color. I saw the night sky, and the clouds ignited with a yellow-red flame and rolled back in all directions. The stars, most of them winked out in an instant, but dozens of them started falling to earth. Then I heard a great wind blowing, and from far away, a voice. In the blackness of that sky, which was no longer a sky, I sensed something stirring. Something meant to be in slumber. Something malevolent and implacable. "Stop," said Yard, and I came to myself again. Al was gone, and the building was on fire around me, hot wind howling past my ears, putting my heart in a ferment. Yard acted as if nothing was amiss. He took the horn, cleaned it, and then placed it in the case. After he had sealed it, he turned to me, shook his head, and offered a hand. I swear, with the building coming down around us, backdrafts and flashovers everywhere, nothing harmed us. He walked us calmly out of the building where Al was waiting with his hands wrapped up. Later, he told me he tried to lift me, to get me out of the building, but I was hot. He said he got burned from touching me. Al is full of shit at the best of times, and he probably touched a banister, but so much crazy stuff was going on that I was willing to believe him. About that time, Shed came doddering down the middle of the road. He left a trail of blood and shredded skin. Yard's shoulders slumped when he saw Shed. "Brother," he said, "this
Sound is not for listen on earth, brother. Not for listen. You know this. Shed's words were still mangled, but we understood him. He turned to me. Why this one's face glowed, please? He blew the trumpet, said Yard. It will be fine. It was for a short time only. Who are you people? Asked Al, quaver in his voice that I ain't never heard out of him before right then. Shed smirked. Yard said, we are two of the seven motherfuckers whose job it is to fuck this reality up when the time comes. But not time yet. And my brother, he knows it, said Shed. I wanted to play, that's all. No harm done. Yard seemed petulant, like the younger of the two. Skin dropped off Shed, and the more he lost his covering, the clearer his speech became. Yeah, I'm gonna disagree with that. I heard you all the way from home, and I was sent to bring you and the trumpet back. You're not even supposed to have it. He came to me and touched my face. You'll be all right. Get some sleep. And stop stealing shit. With that, the flesh of his face slid off, revealing the bone underneath. His jaw fell along with the muscle, leaving his tongue lolling like a prick. He looked at Yard. I can never do these human bodies as well as you do. Take off the vessel. Let's go home. Al and I disagreed on what happened next, but I'm telling the story, so I'll give you my version. They fell into their clothes and shriveled up. Yard, Shed, and the horn, gone. We kicked their clothes into the fire, even though Yard had some fine threads. By the time the cops and the actual feds turned up, we were long gone. That's almost the end of the story. This shit happened in 1944, maybe 45. You don't have to believe me. Shonda spent a lot of time searching for who or what they might be, got entangled with some tinfoil-wearing motherfuckers for a while. She said she had to know, like it was some itch in her brain that she had to scratch or something. I don't know about that. I do know that I have not been sick a day since I touched that horn, and I'm now 95. I still have all my own teeth, and I've outlived two wives. I kicked the cocaine, made some minor waves in bebop, and what came after. Al is still alive, and he was older than me to start with. I'd say we look about 40. Shonda is still alive. She and Al are still on again, off again, or make-ups to break-ups, as I think the kids say these days. Nobody who was in Saucy Sue's the night Yard played died young. That trumpet did something to us all. When I sleep, and I don't sleep much, but when I do, I dream of that thing out there beyond the sky. That thing stirring, waiting to wreak havoc. In some versions, a talon-scaled arm reaches out of the abyss and hands me a horn. I wake up screaming. Then I have to go outside and look at the stars and the moon, or even just the clouds, night air on my face. Then I am fine.
The Woman Who Destroyed Us by S.L. Huang. I know what they say. They say she was a pioneer. They say she helped millions of people live a normal life. They say she created the next stage of evolution for humanity. I need you to understand how wrong that is. to understand what she is. A killer. She's destroying people's minds, molding them into her image of what the human brain should be. And none of them complain afterward, because of course they wouldn't. Their brains are made to be happy, and so they are. She's washing out the human species into mindless automatons. More importantly, she killed my son. Maggie decided on her plan during a sunny afternoon in early April. The weather had bloomed into the fragile clarity of a perfect spring day, the type of day that only came in tiny crystals before being smothered by summer. Maggie went out to get the mail, and instead sat down on her porch and listened to insects chirping and the breeze whistling in the old house's shutters, and wanted to spit on all of it. Perfect days shouldn't be allowed to exist anymore. Maggie closed her eyes and reflected on the irony life had flung at her. First, Henry's diagnoses, and learning she did have the strength to love him, truly and genuinely. Not only the strength, but the desire. Throughout the years, every minute of every day that she'd scraped and scratched out on his behalf had been worth it. Every anxious conference with his doctors, every time she caught him wistfully staring at other children playing and her heart broke a tiny bit more, every too short accounting of funds that went to his care first and always. She vaguely recalled the pain of giving up her engineering career, or of the day Henry's father left. But it was an unfocused sort of pain, tempered by time and willingness. Or perhaps that long-ago pain was nothing now, compared to the bonfire that consumed her every time she recalled the day she'd lost Henry. Her son, her real son, had vanished, replaced by an imposter wearing his face. And if she ever managed to get him back, he would hate her for it. She wondered sometimes if she was being selfish. She'd told herself so many times she would do anything, sacrifice anything, if it would mean a better life for him. But that wasn't supposed to mean sacrificing him. She'd always told nosy strangers that he was fine just the way he was, and she had meant it. But that woman, she had seen how smart Henry was. Maggie had told people how smart he was. That woman had seen it, and had dangled such glittering promises in front of him. Seduced his brain for herself, all with her smug assumption that everyone was better off as carbon copies of her version of normal. That doctor wasn't even a real person herself, was she? All the magazine profiles were gleefully transparent about that. Proud, even. How she'd built her own personality by zapping whatever neural pathways she decided fit her concept of the ideal human. They'd had her up before ethics boards in the early days, for God's sake. Before enough.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.